This video is brought to you by Alice hurling Barboso to the other side of the village after getting sick of- Oh wait, they didn't adapt that bit. Sword Art Online Alicization War of Underworld continues with its first action set piece. The two raids of Alicization invading take place in two separate realities. Alice dons her armor again against the scouting invasion led by goblins and orcs, while on Ocean Turtle, Asuna has to face with what happened to Kirito and make her resolve to save him very clear. Welcome everyone, it's me GamerTurk, your most reliable source of Sword Art Online information with Alicization Explained, featuring War of Underworld Episode 2, Raids. As always, timestamps to individual plot points are in the description as well as the pinned comment for easy navigation, but to give you a quick rundown, the adaptation quality remains pretty accurate and the animation quality is a major step up compared to last week with our first action set piece on display. We also got an absolute masterpiece of an ending sequence this week and we'll briefly talk about that as well at the end. But if you're new to my Explained series, what I do here is essentially provide you all the vital information on characters, events, action, lore from the source material, light novels, things that the anime did not convey properly or just did not have the time to, so you can still see the full picture. So make sure to subscribe and hit that bell icon to not miss any of the details in the upcoming weeks. But then again, if you want to read the books for yourselves for the amazing experience, Amazon and Book Depository affiliate links are in the description and the knowledge of Stacia awaits you there. But without further ado, War of Underworld Episode 2 adapted from exactly where we left off, Volume 15, Alicization Invading, Chapter 15, Part 2, all the way to the end of Chapter 16, Part 3. On a surface level, that is quite a lot of content, about 50 pages. However, just like Episode 1, cutting out Chapter 14, the part that focuses on the Ocean Turtle Raid team was skipped entirely, most certainly being saved for the next episode to feature more of a narrative consistency there. As I presumed in my episode 1 explained, they are making sure that the eased up pacing is there to ensure the adaptation accuracy, and this episode is a major showcase of that. The very first seconds of the episode, I had already started thinking about my rant, but it turns out the episode was just bamboozling me. In episode 1 explained, I mentioned that where the episode ended was not the end of the scene and that it would be a shame if they cut out what followed. Episode 2 started with Alice already in flight, having skipped that scene, but thank god they immediately cut back to it as a flashback. I don't know what the motive was in starting this way instead of just keeping it normal as is, but I can't complain, they did showcase Kirito's state perfectly well. His torn apart soul still exists on a very basic, instinctual level, and this scene is the best showcase of it in the entire Volume 15. Trying to do something, anything to help, but failing to do so as he remains wriggling on the floor. Well, this once again punched Alice in the gut emotionally. She was in disbelief at the determination of the boy without a consciousness. She quickly put him back on his chair and promised to fight and told him to trust her, hoping that Kirito would be able to understand. The one minor complaint I have is that Alice seems to be traversing across the entire region to reach Rulid. The log cabin really is just outside of Rulid, not across the entire forest, but it looks cool I guess, so no worries. When the anime decides to be accurate enough to adapt Alice merely touching Amayori on the neck to tell her to hover nearby, I really can't nitpick such minor things. Reminds me of the Fanatio vs Kirito fight where they specifically animated the 4 thrusts by Fanatio was met by 4 slashes by Kirito, and simply put a smile on my face. Some of you may be thinking how Alice survived dropping from so high up in the sky, but the anime depicts that very clearly as well, despite the light novels not mentioning a single explanation here. The novels simply say that she landed by crushing the pavement near Gusfoot and Barbosa, however the anime goes one step ahead and showcases her using wind elements to first accelerate her descent and then another major blow of wind elements to simply break her descent at the end before she touches the ground. That's just incredible on the anime side and I only have praises this week for it. I love every single scene Gusfoot is on display. The previous two ones, when Alice was being taken away in Human Realm Episode 1 and when he didn't let Alice live in Rulid in War of Underworld Episode 1, those two were more subtle and you could easily come to wrong conclusions without reading the novels that he was really regretting what he had to do instead of making a very black and white decision, but here, this one is portrayed amazingly. He simply has no other choice but to disregard Alice the criminal's orders, because the authority in such a case was not even his. In the case of an attack, it was the man-at-arms who had the authority, and the young Zink without enough experience had ordered them to stay here and defend the village. Even Gusfoot, as the chief elder, could say nothing in the situation. He did not have a decision to make. The decision was made by the imperial law, and Gusfoot was utterly powerless. Some observations of Alice regarding the situation, you know, about Gusfoot's position, Zink's experience or lack thereof, and Barbossa's hostility naturally was skipped as an internal monologue by her, but I believe the anime already showcases these visually just fine. When Alice saw she had absolutely no other choice though, she knew she had to become who she really was, an integrity knight. And her announcement, fueled by her determination to protect the people, had resulted in a minor wave of incarnation that even traversed into the area of the oncoming hordes of enemies, and they all stood still for a moment, completely overtaken by the aura. And of course, with the proclamation that Alice was an integrity knight, Gusfoot Truberg was relieved that for once he could do what he felt was right and start the evacuation on the orders of a knight of the Axiom Church. After all, Alice was the third in Integrity Knight hierarchy following Commander Barkuli and Vice Commander Fanatio, and before anyone asks, yes, she could technically lie, but the villagers have no reason to assume she would, because it would be a breach of the taboo index to impersonate an Integrity Knight and to lie openly like this. Remember, the villagers simply don't know Alice can willingly break the taboo index, as their only encounter with her breaking the index was when she accidentally broke it without realizing. Such determined and conscious announcement of this is in no way possible to be a lie in the eyes of the villagers. Barbossa had issues with the order, however, not wanting to leave behind, and this is the moment I'm truly sad they skipped, because I really wanted to see this. He simply refused to leave even after Alice's and Gusfoot's orders to do so. To be frank, if he continued to resist, he would probably receive the sec fault in his floodlight due to being stuck between protecting his assets and following orders, similar to Higa's floodlight copy in episode 6 and Ryo's back in episode 10, and would have simply crashed dead. But Alice did not let him wander that far by grabbing his collar and simply throwing him down the southern stairs into the evacuation area, getting sick of his shitstorm since she arrived. That was a moment that I truly would have loved to see. And the action scene, well, what is even there to say? Since the beginning of the episode, the animation had been very good, especially compared to the lackluster episode 1 framing. While I'm happy with the action scene, I know a lot of people are bound to have issues with the quote-unquote action, that it is too not action-y enough. Since it's Amayori blasting a horde of enemies and then Alice standing still to destroy another horde with the perfect weapon control of a Rosmanthus blade, the thing is, a majority of War of Underworld battles are like this. Very rarely you will get to see personal fights, especially in Core 3, so until about episode 12. If I am to make an analogy between Integrity Knights and a real world, EKs are not special forces soldiers, they are simply nukes that you unleash upon the enemy hordes. Very rarely they are forced to fight into actual sword battles and just use their enhanced armament and memory release skills to obliterate enemies standing almost completely still in most cases. So, just to set your expectations accordingly, engaging and personal fight scenes will be a rarity, especially in the first half of War of Underworld. But while it was a big moment for Alice to come to terms with becoming an Integrity Knight and once again taking up the role of being a protector of the Human Empire, she still does have a lot of personal obstacles to overcome and pain to endure in her ideals. Later that night, Alice headed for the End Mountains, and instead of collapsing the caverns like Eldri did, which the orcs and goblins were able to dig through regardless, she simply collapsed the walls that kept the water flow at bay and used cryogenic elements to freeze up the water once it filled all the caverns. With fall almost over and winter approaching, that would keep the enemies away unless they had dark mages they were using up heat elements to melt the ice, which Alice assumed was unlikely. Considering after saying her farewells to Selka, she headed for the End Mountains, I'll just go ahead and assume that that is what the anime wanted to signify, only the next morning instead of the prior night, which makes no difference in the grand scheme of things. But unlike Underworld, where winter is approaching, Ocean Turtle is only getting hotter. As mentioned, episode 1 and 2 skipped a bunch of scenes so far from the perspective of the bad guys and will probably bundle them up for the next episode, so once again I will skip over those scenes again. Don't worry if next episode does not adapt them, I will definitely let you know in an Alicization Explained special episode, much like the Zakaria tournament chapter, so make sure to subscribe to not miss any of that if it ever happens. But what's happening on the good guy's side on the Ocean Turtle is pretty self-explanatory and accurate, so I won't go too deep into it. If you're confused as to what happened to Kirito, despite the fact that Higa explained it in detail, please do check my What Happened to Kirito video, where I brought a lot of that context into a more understandable manner, so the video will definitely help you in that case. It's a couple of minutes long and I don't feel like repeating myself for that long in this video, so we're just moving on. Asuna being completely fed up with Kikuoka's shenanigans, it is a powerful moment. I talked about this back in my trailer explained videos, but there is nothing truly weird about such an act considering the characters and their past, so I'll reiterate again shortly. While Kiku is a military official, he's not your typical Hollywood military general guy. He is the tech geek of the military and is a pretty well reserved and calm person in general. On top of this, he is fully aware how much he has fucked up since the beginning, as well as aware of Asuna's past and respects her in general. As for Asuna having the guts to hold a military official by his collar and lift him up, their relationship goes both ways. Asuna is very much aware what kind of a person Kikuoka Seijiro is. They spent a whole lot of time in real world and in Alfheim Online. She already has a severe distrust towards the guy since the beginning and has been making him know that since the very beginning as well. And at this point where Kiku has colossally failed at everything he attempted to do, got found out by them, causing Kirito to die worse than he has already died, Asuna simply is so fed up at that point she simply doesn't care about the possible repercussions, while Kiku is respectful and also wimpy enough to not make an issue out of it. And you can even see it's just a major outburst on Asuna's side as she simply falters only for Rinko to aid her keep standing after such an intense moment. And while Higa's words on how to fix Kirito were not adapted yet, it was very clear what Asuna intended to do with that final shot. The post-credit scene is our focus next week, so I won't say anything this week, but you already saw a returning villain from Aincrad right there, so stay tuned. The ending, however, is an absolute masterpiece. Unlasting by Lisa, along with those visuals all focusing on Alice's mentality, how alone and lost she feels, the emotional turmoil she is going through, her one source of hope and light being depicted as this vague memory of an ideal calmly smiling back at her, she reaches the end of it all with the bright gateway only to wake up alone on the cold ground by herself as if the hope, the solution she found, was a dream and nothing more. A lot of you asked me to make an explained video on the ending and to be frank, this is all the explanation to it. Unlike the opening that depicted dozens of scenes from volume 15 all the way up to volume 17, as well as the glaring hint at the very ending of Alicization in that little puddle of water that I simply decided not to elaborate on in the opening explained video because I felt like spoiling the very end of Alicization was just too much to do, the ending only portrays one single abstract concept, Alice's mind. She's alone, she's lost as if she's in a misty forest, falling down with all the pain and despair, looking for a solution towards an ideal that doesn't speak back to her, and she wakes up on the ground all by herself with no answers, at all utterly destroyed. That's simply all there is to it, and all the incredible animation and lyrics highlight that. Speaking of the animation, I'm really glad to see this episode was a major step up from episode 1. Last week really did have me worried. This week, it seems like they will do their best to ensure the action scenes will have good animation quality, but I really do want to highlight the animation quality when Alice was leaving Rulid while saying her goodbyes to Selka. The drawing quality was stellar in that scene, on the level of Quinella's eyelashes, mind you, back in the Human Realm arc adaptation, so it was incredibly refreshing to see such high detail and animation quality again. I do hope there will be more of these sprinkled around in the future, rather than the ones like these. But next episode is titled The Final Load Test, which I'm confused as to why Crunchyroll simply did not go with the official term Final Stress Test, while being committed to every single other translation term Yampress has so far, but yeah, it's almost clear that we will have an episode focusing on Subtilizer, hopefully his past, present, and his future goals. Although it's not very clear how far the next episode will go, I mean, with that kind of an episode title, I can assume it's going as far as the end of volume 15, but it's highly unlikely considering we are barely halfway into the book in the first two episodes, so Aside from the focus on Subtilizer, we may actually have some scenes in the Dark Territories, Obsidia Palace, and finally get to meet the commander of the Dark Knights Brigade as well, although I'm hoping he will have his own dedicated episode instead. Either way, if you made it this far, comment Wrath of Asuna in the comments to let me know. My schedule is returning to normal as well, so weekly Alicization Q&A will be continuing this week, where I will be answering your questions. Ask your questions in the comments or on Twitter, and please do use hashtag AskGamerTurf so I can properly reach your questions. With all the Alicization hype, I am getting way too many comments and questions, and I don't want to accidentally miss out on your question. And using hashtag AskGamerTurf makes it very easy for me to see all of them by simply filtering out everything else. If you have a question regarding future spoilers, please do use a spoiler warning and pull about 5-6 blank lines before asking your question. We don't do it like Fox and Anime here, spoiling the anime-only audience excitedly waiting for future episodes is something I don't want to do, and I'd be glad if you were to respect that. Fate Grand Opinions will also come back this week, so remember to subscribe and hit the bell icon for that as well as more in-depth coverage of Sword Art Online. Like if you enjoyed, check out channel merch, there'll be tons more stuff as the anime progresses there. Huge thanks to my patrons and YouTube channel members as always, and until next time, stay cool.